you. Thank you. I think I just forgot all the stuff that I was going to say tonight. I was trying to figure out what my opening line was going to be, and I said I was going to talk about two things, and I mentioned this to my wife, and she said, well, first thing is, don't embarrass me, and the second thing is, don't embarrass me. And then my daughter heard it, and she said, don't embarrass mom, and don't embarrass us. But the two things that I was going to talk to you about God, and the other one was to talk to you about chewing bubble gum. And right now, I'm all out of bubble gum, so we're going to talk about God. So before we get going, I'd like to take a short moment for prayer. It is said, as Anne said, where two or three are gathered, there, Lord, you are in our midst. So come, Holy Spirit, come by the most powerful means of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, your well-beloved spouse, and teach us to pray. Heavenly Father, we give you praise and thanksgiving always. You are the truth, and we are scared. Help us not to be afraid, except to have fear of the Lord, because you are so awesome. Thank you for being such a great dad. Give us the gifts that we need to help us be wise, courageous, but most importantly, to be obedient to you. And we pray, St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast him into hell and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. So I wanted to start with a quick clip of how I hope this evening may go.
Hey! Who wants to have some fun?
I do.
Now, you just saying you want to have fun, or do you really want to have fun?
I really want to have fun.
I'm just saying I want to have some fun.
So I'm hoping you all want to be like Jerry and not like George, but I can guarantee you I'm not going to be like Kramer. So before we get started, we probably should talk about the elephant in the room. And that's what happened to my hair. So, in David Letterman true fashion, number 10, my hats were no longer fitting. I was going through way too much on hair care products. I was tired of answering all the questions about it, but now I'm going to have the same questions about why I cut it. My wife was wondering what was happening to all her hairspray. My daughters did not want me to visit them at college for fear of their friends seeing me because they thought I looked like a creeper. 5, the drain was getting plugged now with my hair instead of my daughter's. There was too many fights over hairbrushes and ponytail holders. My mom told me to cut it. It was interfering with my sleep, and it was just time, as you can tell. So usually with most talks, there are disclosures and objectives of the evening that need to be discussed regarding what I hope to convey. There's usually a test at the end, but we're going to skip that for the clarity of time. But first, I just want to let everybody know that I love being Catholic. I'm not a theologian. I'm not here to give medical advice, just medical information. I am broken. I am still a lot afraid, and I've shamelessly borrowed from many wise people, and they've influenced me in many ways, and I hope they take it as a form of flattery and not as a litigious opportunity. I work at St. Gianna Clinic, and I'll be name-dropping them from time to time. And lastly, all praise and glory belong to God. So for the goals and objectives, first I just want us to realize that God is everywhere and that he loves us and does not want us to be afraid. We need to allow him to be in control of our lives. As we always say, Jesus, we trust in you. I hope to give you a little bit of background on how I got here. I'll talk a little bit about healthcare and how it's changing and how true Catholic healthcare could look with the guidance from the divine physician and how that fits into St. Gianna Clinic. I often wonder what non-medical people think these days about healthcare. How confident are you and what has been going on in the medical field. Briefly, I'll touch upon a few topics in healthcare, as my kids say, spill the tea, so to speak, on some issues that challenge our Catholic perspectives and our commitment to faith. I'll take a few questions. Hope to offer you a challenge at the end, and hopes that you'll find some little nugget or two that you can take home and chew on, and maybe provide you some sustenance. And lastly, hope to not be ill up on stage. So, how did I get here? And speaking of being ill, the number one fear for most people is public speaking. Even worse is public speaking about yourself or giving testimonials. So how did this come about? Certainly nothing that I was searching for, as Anne can tell you. God can be funny that way. I really prefer to be in the background. I joined St. John a Clinic back in January of 2022 during the midst of COVID, and somehow the group at Spiritus reached out to me to give a talk on how the Holy Spirit had touched my life and guided me towards St. John a Clinic. I too, at that time, tried to get out of that talk, but was unsuccessful and eventually agreed. It was supposed to be a 20-minute talk, and I think I had maybe about 10 minutes worth of material. I finished the talk, threw it away, figured I was sure that was going to be a done deal. That was back in March of 2023. Fast forward to May 16th, when I get a text from the CIA. They were wondering if I would put this one-man band back together again for a reunion gig with them. I countered hard to convince them I wasn't even a one-hit wonder back then, and that they got the wrong man. What could I possibly talk about to this group? So my first thoughts were, no. I've been to Spiritus, I've done that, I don't think so. My second one was, why me? I've been to these talks, and I know what caliber of speakers they've had. Patrick Madrid, Father Girardi, Father Michael Leitner, Mike Mothy. I didn't think I would fit in. I was pretty sure I was busy that day, and I usually use, I think I'm on call, as that excuse. But my gold standard excuse is, I have to check with my wife. And lastly, I just really didn't feel like I was worthy to talk. So I asked, stalled for some time to contemplate what my next steps would be and how I could get out of it. The trouble was they had 5 slots open, and I didn't think I was going to come up with enough excuses. So I sought counsel with my boss at that time, and she said that it might be a good idea to spread the word about true Catholic healthcare. So here I am, to give witness about my journey that led me to St. John a Clinic. And I've always been reminded of God's great sense of humor, but I did not think anything was very funny so far. So Ann and I had to come up with a name for the talk, and she asked me to throw out a couple of ideas, and we, or maybe it was really her, that came up with the Be Not Afraid. In retrospect, I did come up with a couple of other possibilities, and that was, do not be afraid, but be terrified. And my favorite, what in the hell was I thinking? So having finally named the talk, it was now time to procrastinate. Maybe something would happen, the talk would eventually be canceled, or Jim Caviezel may want to take my spot. There could be a snowstorm. So while I procrastinated over the summer, I was encouraged to sign up for the Catholic Medical Association's Continuing Medical Education Conference. I never knew that such an organization existed until my boss told me about it. I didn't even know they offered education. So I went to the website, looked at the conference, seeing what it had to offer, and remember God's sense of humor? The conference's name was Do Not Be Afraid. The patrons of that conference were the archangels, Gabriel for healing, Raphael for communication, and Michael to act. Speaker after speaker shared their witness of being a Catholic in a secular world, especially in the field of medicine. The struggles and life events that they went through, it really made me think of my journey, and mine really pales in comparison to what they had gone through. It was also at that conference that one of the speakers raised the question, If you were accused of being a Christian or a Catholic, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Now, I don't believe I'd ever thought of it or heard of it before, but that question confirmed that I really didn't know if I was worthy to be up on the stage talking to you, because I didn't know what a jury would think about my case. Would I be acquitted or would I be convicted? How do I live my life with what I say to others, what I read, what I watch on TV, how I tithe? What would my friends and coworkers say about me? Would they be witnesses for the prosecution, or would they be witnesses for the defense? It also made me think about a conference I'm currently attending called That Man Is You. And if there's any men out here, I would highly recommend attending. The first class talked about if you are a good guy. And the quick test was, how many of the Ten Commandments do you keep? The leader of the series had been talking to his friends, and they actually came up with 2.5. It started me thinking about what I needed to do differently and how those changes may not only benefit myself, but society in general. So procrastination turned into tomorrow, many tomorrows, and I still was contemplating what I was going to say. I've talked to many priests who say they really don't prepare homilies, they just let the Holy Spirit guide them. And I thought, wow, that would be great. I think I'm going to do that too. Until I started to panic and eventually had to start writing something down. I also figured I'd need some sort of distraction, so I thought maybe I should create some slides as well. I had to come up with like 40 minutes of material with this talk, and it turns out I might have more to say than I thought. I'm now confident I can get us out of here by 9:45. So I have to give a shout out to my daughter, Peyton May. She helped me with the slide production. The content is mine, but Peyton May showed me how to format the slides. Peyton May joked that I should make sure I mentioned that she, Peyton May, helped me, but I didn't know if I should mention Peyton May's name directly. So if you see her, don't make a big fuss about it. I always wondered why God wouldn't just come right out and tell me or tell us what to do when we pray to him. It would make life so much easier. I've often heard, and you may have too, God told me this or God told me that. I too would like to have been spoken to with an obvious direct connection. But Father Mike Schmitz said, it might help us or make it easier for us to believe in God, but it still would not make it any easier for us to truly belong to God. So after re-preparing for this talk, I again have come to find out that God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, the Trinity talks to me more than I give them credit. But it would be more of a whisper than that opening in the sky, booming voice I would so love to hear. So who am I? Ann mentioned a little bit, but I am the youngest of 6 boys and grew up on the mean streets of Slinger, Wisconsin. I was supposed to be the daughter my dad never had. I do believe I would have been named Mary Claire if it was my mom, or Joan by my dad in honor of Joan of Arc. But my mom was cursed with yet another boy. And initially, I was going to be called Larry, but alas, it was Edward. I was a cradle Catholic. Went to school at St. Peter's, grades 1 through 6, was an altar boy, finished school at public school in Slinger, still attended CCD, but back in the day, that was Monday night. It always seemed to interfere with Monday night football. Luckily, the Packers weren't very good back then, and I rarely had to run home to catch the opening highlight package, although many of you may remember the Washington Redskins, Green Bay Packer, 48-47 game. That was a classic. So you don't really appreciate it at the time, but now I realize how blessed that I was. That, number one, I was But more importantly, how lucky to be born of Catholic parents who not only practiced their faith, but drug us to all the services, First Fridays, Holy Days, rosaries after supper, despite our attempts to not have them do it. My mom, who is almost 91, was valedictorian of her class, but became a homemaker. She waitressed on the side. She was also working at the school office and the library. She was a seamstress, a canner, a gardener, a short order cook, the rock of home life. My dad, now passed away almost 15 years, worked three jobs, 7 days a week, enjoyed his well-deserved beer, was the provider, and if mom was the rock, he was the boulder. The quiet type of boulder like St. Joseph. I mentioned five brothers. My first brother got a job out of high school, married young, started a family, eventually went to tech school to do HVAC. He loves the outdoors, hunting, fishing. He can fix all types of stuff. He's a handyman. My second brother was the first to go to college. Analytical, became an engineer. Mr. Common Sense. He changes the trajectory of post-high school expectations, as when I was young, I thought you just completed high school, graduated, and then got a job and got married. Third brother, second to go to college, first to live in the dorms, financial whiz, first to adventure cross country in terms of his dreams, extremely charitable and giving, my first exposure to apologetics. My fourth brother was the third to go to college. He was a prom king, Mr. Popular, the guy who everybody loves. Fifth brother is the fourth to go to college, valedictorian, prom king, funny. We call him the Edge, as he always has a different outlook on things and often follows to a different drummer. So as you can see, I was pushed to be like them in many ways. So after high school, I figured I'd go to college as well. All my brothers started off at the community college, but a high school friend of mine convinced me that I had to go to Madison and we had to be roommates. So I did go to Madison, and no, we did not become roommates. Ironically, we were in the same complex, but different wings. Same floor, same room number, but it just didn't work out. So back then in the 80s, to register for classes, there was no such thing as computers, and Al Gore had not yet invented the internet. It was old school, wild, wild west. You registered in person at the building where the classes were offered. I registered either second last or in the last group of freshmen after everyone else had registered. And despite help from my brother, registration was a bust. Most of the classes I wanted were gone and were already filled. I was left with some slim pickings and got stuck with Geology 101, which was known then as Rocks for Jocks, and Zoology 101. I was thinking I was going to go into engineering, but it appears God's plan was a possible path towards biology instead. I was thrust into dorm life and on my own. As mentioned, my friend and I didn't match, but I did get a new roommate who was a pretty good guy, but he preferred smoking the devil's lettuce and often seemed to miss his classes. He ended up needing to take a semester off, the polite way of saying he was suspended. There was a sophomore girl on the floor who would gather people up to go to church. So I went. I'm not sure what would have happened had she not bravely expressed her intentions. It also happened around that time I met a good boy, we'll call him Keith, who eventually became a roomie for the rest of my undergrad life, who also was a Catholic boy, and we just made it a point to go. By this time, I was a junior, and I was contemplating medicine, as a zoology degree wasn't going to get me very far. I decided to shadow my pediatrician and thought, this could work out. He drives a Jeep. I like being childish. I really wouldn't need to grow up. I can talk about pee and poop all the time. And the body really fascinated me. God is just an amazing creator. So I decided I'd try to go to medical school. And I'd have two choices back then. It was either UW or Medical College of Wisconsin, which we fondly known as MCOW. Finances at the time would only allow me in-state tuition. Around this time, I met a girl. I worked with her sister at the research lab on campus, and she just happened to be Catholic as well, and we would go to Mass regularly. Sometimes there might have been a free breakfast involved when her parents happened to be there too. I did get accepted to medical school at UW, and I kept dating this girl too. I continued to do my weekly duties by punching the clock at church, but I would say I didn't understand my faith very much at the time. I went to visit my brothers, numbers 3 and 5, out in California during a spring break trip, and somewhere in the late evening, on a road trip from LA to Palm Springs, my brother and I had a most intense conversation about Catholicism and Marian apparitions. Not what I pictured from my partying brother, but I always look at that moment as a turning point in terms of my faith. Med school was coming to a close and residency was to follow. I decided to go into pediatrics, and if possible, I was going to do a sports medicine fellowship. My dream job was to be a team doctor for a university. UW's team doctors for many of their sports were a pediatrician. Madison and UW had said, "It's time for you to move away." I'm not sure if they just had enough of me or if they knew a change in venue would be a good thing and a different experience. So I chose to go to Vanderbilt University in Nash Vegas, Tennessee to complete my residency. They were one of the 4 pediatric sports medicine programs in the country at the time. And you remember that girl? I met her 6 years before. Well, yeah, I married her in the beginning of my 2nd year. And she had our first daughter near the end of year 3. Now it was time to make a decision about that fellowship. I couldn't get a feel if I would get into the 2-year program at Vanderbilt, and at that time, I was trying to make a decision. A friend of mine from medical school told me about a job that he had interviewed in Appleton, but he decided he was going to take the offer in Oshkosh instead. He said I should look into the Appleton job. Strangely, another med school friend had interviewed for that same Appleton job, but he decided to take a job with the competition. I interviewed and accepted the job he turned down. Turns out, we both looked at the same house in Appleton, which he bought. I then joined LaSalle Clinic back in 1997. There have been a couple of name changes to Affinity and then to Ascension, and my wife and I had a couple of more girls. At that time, my wife insisted that our girls were going to Catholic school. She had gone, I had gone, and they were going. We were Catholic Central Eagles! Yeah! All right. My day back then off was Thursdays, which coincidentally was Mass Day. I was now a 2-day-a-week Mass goer. When I was young, I always wondered what those old people were doing in church. Why did they go to daily Mass, like every day? Didn't they know you only really have to go to church once a week? They go and pray the rosary, they probably read the Bible, but I was starting to become one of those old people. I slowly climbed the ladder at work in terms of administration, not because I was good at it, but rather no one else really wanted to do it. And I was now the father of 4 girls and had been at my job for 23 years, and then COVID-19. Just as COVID-19 was ramping up, I stumbled across a group of doctors from the likes of Harvard, Oxford, Stanford, who had prepared a document called the Great Barrington Declaration. This was a common sense approach to public health management of pandemics. It sounded like good medical advice at the time. It was interesting as it appeared that the country was doing exactly the opposite of what normally would have been recommended for managing a public health emergency. I signed it in October of 2020. At that time, I felt like a rebel. I was going against the status quo, but I was hopeful that common sense would prevail. So what did the Great Barrington Declaration state? I quote, "Those who are not vulnerable should immediately be allowed to resume life as normal. Simple hygiene measures such as hand washing and staying home when sick should be practiced by everyone to reduce the herd immunity threshold. Schools and universities should be open for in-person teaching. Extracurricular activities such as sports should be resumed. Young, low-risk adults should work normally rather than from home. And lastly, restaurants and other businesses should be open. Arts, music, sports, and other cultural activities should resume. People who are more at risk may participate if they wish, while society as a whole enjoys the protection conferred upon the vulnerable by those who have built up herd immunity. At this time, COVID vaccine was being introduced in December of 2020. Fast forward to the summer of 2021, when very big decisions were going to need to be made, as my workplace was requiring the COVID vaccine. I initially told myself I was going to give the vaccine 6 months to see if anything weird was happening and to research what was being used to make the vaccine. I was not happy that most of the vaccine lines were either derived from aborted fetal lines or the aborted cells were being used in testing of the vaccines. I did think it was rather strange that they were offering all kinds of incentives and enticements to people to get a vaccine. They were offering money, burgers, fries, my favorite, beer, donuts, joints, and lottery tickets. I was now at a crossroads making one of the most difficult decisions I had ever made. It basically boiled down to the truth, and things were not making sense. I'm not sure who said it, but it seemed like good advice that faith plus reason equals truth, and I just wanted the truth. Could I leave my job of 24 years? It was super comfortable. It had good pay, good benefits. For a job that had a longer commute, less pay and benefits, and more unknowns so that I wouldn't jeopardize my beliefs. I could just follow protocol or I was going to lose my job. And it wasn't just me. There were many other healthcare professionals who were in the same situation. I had devoted 24 years of my practice, and I had planned on being there until I retired. Now I was going to lose my job, my income, my benefits, part of my pension, insurance, relationships that I've built with colleagues, relationships with families and parents. And would my family understand? I still had 3 kids in various forms of schooling. Somehow, some way, God always seems to intervene. Sometimes like a whisper, sometimes more obvious. I felt that somewhere along the line, I was being lied to. Either I had received a faulty education at medical school, or I was somehow being deceived. I was going through my news feeds one night after work, as we all had some extra time on our hands due to COVID, and I happened to be reading an op-ed piece that expressed exactly what I was feeling. I was like, yeah, this is totally how I feel. This is spot on. And to top it off, I thought I recognized the author, Dr. Blankety Blank. No way. I literally jumped out of my bed, ran down the stairs, and asked my wife to read the letter as well. She agreed with what was said. And then I tell her, like Buddy the Elf, when Santa was coming to the mall.
Time for the announcement.
Okay, people, tomorrow morning, 10 a.m., Santa's coming to town.
Santa! Oh, my God!
Santa here? I know him. I know him.
And I did know him. I think I reached out to him to thank him and find out if it really was him. And soon thereafter, he gathered a small group of like-minded health professionals who felt similar or were going to be in the same boat of losing employment. I no longer felt like a misfit. I had some hope. If my religious exemption did not pan out, I at least had some other contacts to commiserate with. We met several times to support each other and consider what else could we do differently to help others and our patients who had so many questions. Truly, this faith-filled group made me believe that everything was going to work out. It became apparent that things were not going to work out at my job, as I would no longer be qualified to continue working there. God introduced me to an angel that worked at another clinic, and she offered me the opportunity to become a pediatrician at St. Gianna Clinic. It would be a challenge, a 25-mile commute instead of 1 mile, less pay, less benefits, being the only pediatrician always on call, building a new practice, somewhat daunting at my old age in life. And I guess I should have been scared, but strangely, it did not scare me. I have reconciled that God is my boss. Father Mike Schmitz talks about how God sets us apart as his people. We are unique as Catholics, and therefore we're actually held to a different standard. We are part of everything, but belong to nothing other than God. We are called to be holy, even in terms of our labor. In Exodus 31, Aholiab and Bezalel were set out to be artistic craftsmen by God. Not only were they good at it, but they were filled with the Spirit of God. Us, as ordinary laborers, can do great and exceptional work, provided we are doing it for God. No matter what our job or state in life, provided that we have the Holy Spirit in us, we can do great things. And all throughout the Bible, there are ordinary people doing amazing things, like David versus Goliath, Samson and the Philistine, especially after he lost his powers, Jesus in his human form versus the Romans. And let's not forget the ladies out there, Mary with her fiat, and one of my favorites, Judith. All the saints who are too numerous to mention. It is obvious that we believe in God, but do we truly belong to him? I am blessed to be part of a clinic that values Christian principles and life. A clinic that respects patients and their decisions on what they feel is right for their children and themselves. I'm also humbled that many former patients have made the commute to still see me. So who or what is St. Gianna Clinic? We are founded on the principles that life is important. St. Gianna gave her life to bring her baby into the world. Both of them were physicians, and St. Gianna guides us, as well as the divine physician, on how we take care of our patients. We are a small but growing healthcare clinic that started in 2014 as a formal 501c3 nonprofit clinic. While remaining our own independent nonprofit, we worked with and formed an affiliation with HSHS in Green Bay in February of 2015 to jointly open a St. Gianna clinic in June of 2015. We then branched off to become fully independent again in 2020 and now consist of two OBGYN physicians and two fertility-trained nurses, one full-time and one part-time family medicine physician, one soon-to-be nurse practitioner in family medicine, one pediatrician, and one part-time psychiatrist. We provide care from conception until end of life and all ages in between with specialty areas of fertility care, natural family planning, and NAPRO technology and surgery. We take care of men, women, children who are either insured, underinsured, or not insured at all. We turn no one away. Because of our small size, we do struggle with reimbursement for our services from the insurance companies. Bigger healthcare organizations get better, higher reimbursement rates for the same care that we provide. We are a non-for-profit company and do rely on donations from people, companies, and non-for-profit groups who truly support Catholic healthcare. So remember that talk I told you about that I went to that past summer? It had some great opportunities and information for reflection, and I'd like to share some of that information with you. Hopefully, this will shed some light on what's going on in our crazy world right now. 27% of Americans, that's one out of four, have anxiety. Half of those individuals are now on medication. 61% of people say they're lonely. Much of this fear of the unknown, fear of health, fear of COVID, fear of the economy. We are easily distracted by all the things we consume in news and entertainment. Where is God in our lives? Life has just become too big. The size of the corporations and hospitals, just to name a few. There's too much information available via technology, and it is hard to know what is true and what isn't. It incapacitates us, giving more powers to entities like the government. And there are nine words that no one wants to hear. I'm from the government and I'm here to help. The world is seemingly driving out love. And if God is love, it's driving out love, making us more selfish as it numbs and dulls our senses. Father Ryan had mentioned to me something that he called the light analogy. He explains how farmers and city folks view light differently. For the farmer, his day begins and ends with the sun. It tells him when to get up and when to go to bed. The crops are dependent to grow. The farmer is thankful for the sun. He loves the greenness of the grass and of his crops. He loves the long summer days and enjoys time in the lake or the pond. He often eats things that he grows. The shorter days means it's time for the harvest. He marvels at night at the stars in the sky, and he understands the Creator and how dependent he is on him. The city dweller is used to the concrete, the commute, the noise. He is used to the lights of the street, or the traffic signal, or the lights in his office. This person feels like he is more the Creator and is in charge of all the goings on. His food is often found in vending machines or by going out to eat. They have two totally different viewpoints. So let's get back to not being afraid. Courage is found on a continuum. You can be bold, you can be rash, you can be courageous, you can be cowardice, or you can have fear. Courage is overcoming fear. Having no courage may just be reckless or careless, such as jumping into something without thinking or caring. We must be prudent. It is said in Revelation 21:8 that cowards do not make it to heaven. It also says, neither do liars. So, strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. I recently learned that of all the apostles, the only one to return to the foot of the cross was John. He was brave to return. He was also the only apostle who did not undergo martyrdom. This is not to say that the others deserved what they got, but maybe we should not be afraid to bring our crosses to the foot of Jesus and see how things turn out. It states in the Catechism, and I quote, "Fortitude is the moral virtue that ensures firmness in difficulties and constancy in the pursuit of the good. It strengthens the resolve to resist temptations and to overcome obstacles in the moral life. The virtue of fortitude enables one to conquer fear, even fear of death, and to face trials and persecutions. It disposes one even to renounce and sacrifice one's life in defense of a just cause. Quote, the Lord is my strength and my song. In the world you have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." There are several types of courage. There's physical courage, standing up to a bully, not being afraid to take on the team that's better than you. There's moral courage, which is standing up for what's right. And there's psychological courage, such as dealing with a personal illness like cancer, abuse, or mental illness. You can choose courage or comfort, but you really can't have them both. Some of the characteristics that people with courage have, they will face fear, but yet choose action. They follow their heart, or they follow God. This can be seen in the story of Moses and the 12 spies. Moses sends them out to check out the promised land. 10 come back saying, there's no way we can beat these guys, they're way too big. But Joshua and Caleb come back and say, we can take them. Why did Joshua and Caleb see things differently? The fact is, they had courage in what God had done for them in Egypt. People with courage tend to persevere in the face of adversity. They don't give up, they give it up to God. We must be brave to start and have the endurance to finish. People with courage stand up for what's right. We mention this with moral courage, and we need courage for the other virtues. Number 5, they expand their horizons and let go of the familiar. They trust in God. Some of St. John Paul II's first words or themes in his pontificate were, "Do not be afraid." It is mentioned more than 350 times in the Bible. Trust in the Lord. How many times in the Bible, or better yet, in our own lives, do we or they not listen to what God says? Or worse yet, when it comes to making decisions, do we not ask for counsel from our Lord? Lastly, they face suffering and eventually death with dignity. So, medicine is changing and expanding all the time. It was one of the things that initially attracted me to the profession, as there was always going to be things to learn. With all this change, nothing is more noticeable than medical terminology. For example, how medicine and more importantly, the media are desensitizing us to make things seem more normal. Nothing could be seen more in transsexual surgery. This was a rare occurrence back years ago, and now you're seeing changes in terminology such as sex reassignment surgery, followed by gender reassignment surgery, coming up to gender confirming surgery, and lastly, gender affirming surgery, always trying to make it more palatable for us Americans. Medical society even changed the definition of what a vaccine is from preventing a disease to decreasing symptoms of a disease. There are numerous medical examples out there, and I'm sure you could shout them out at me as fast as I can say them. There's now birthing parent instead of mother. There is now chest feeding instead of breastfeeding. There are people who menstruate instead of women, and not to be outdone, people with prostates for men. Lastly, the one that's the most scary is minor attracted person, which is to soften up being a pedophile. You've also seen this in who's playing and what sports now and what bathrooms you can use. As Catholics, we propose ideas. We do not impose our thoughts onto others, but we do have every right to speak up and bring about discussions on these topics. Sometimes it almost seems like we are too polite. So some of the topics that we're going to talk about, I think I have four. The first one would be end-of-life issues. You will start to see a push for more physician-assisted suicide and euthanasia. This is real, and we are entering a slippery slope as desensitization is already happening in other countries. Legislation already introduced in countries north of us, such as Canada, they have something called the MAID program, which stands for Medical Assistance in Death. This is for people approaching the end of life, and even for those people with mental health issues, like depression, who feel they just can't go on any longer, even in children. So far, 50,000 deaths have occurred as a result of this. Canada, which has a population of 40 million, that's 0.1% of their population has been assisted in their death. As Catholics, we must be proactive and continue to be pro-life. We should be promoting palliative care, which allows for the elevation of the dignity of the person who's dying. It also allows family members to be present and to participate, and it allows somebody to be accompanied instead of being abandoned. It teaches us empathy as we get to know them and their situation, and provides comfort and instills hope that they are not alone. Who hasn't been involved in screens or electronics with their kids? We all know increase in screen time increases somatic complaints, such as headache, stomach aches, sleep problems, and recently lots of neck issues from everybody looking down at their phones. It also increases risk-taking behavior as they've seen things on the TikTok challenges that are out there, which also leads to increase in rule breaking, and if I'm not mistaken, one of the TikTok challenges was stealing cars. Only 30% of teens prefer to communicate in person. They are not good at making eye contact, and they have poor interviewing skills. There are also many issues with all the social media apps. There is a constant popularity contest, and this seems to affect our female adolescents, and it also affects their self-esteem. All they see on Snapchat, TikTok, Instagram are beautiful girls who are skinny, who are on vacation, and who have everything, and it makes their lives feel like they're inconsequential. Unfortunately, the information is known immediately and is forever. Some of these things are held on for years only to surface later, affecting somebody's scholarship, school admittance, or job. There's also the new form of sexploitation and sextortion, where they get people to send them nude pictures of themselves only to be held ransom that they're going to be spread across the internet. Many suicides have occurred in this form of sexploitation and sextortion. Father Ryan often mentions that screens do not love you back. Now we'll go to a few more controversial issues, and I felt really bad when I was coming up with the header for this. it came up as female problems, which just didn't sound very good. So it's really issues that affect females. And first, we'll talk a little bit about menstruation. And something that I just recently found out, and I'm embarrassed to say, as I've been a medical professional for over 30 years, functional reproduction is healthy. All the body systems in the body are independent. Your heart is independent, your gut is independent, your brain is independent, your lungs are independent. There's only one system that is only partially complete, and that is your reproductive system. And you can't complete it with just any reproductive system. You need the opposite half. Two, the pill is not good for you. It increases the risk of sexually transmitted diseases as well as psychological disorders. And NAPRO technology can help be more natural. So what is NAPRO? I didn't know. I only heard about this 2 years ago when I joined St. Gianna Clinic. I had to ask a colleague what it was all about. So back in the 1960s, St. Pope Paul VI had serious concerns about the pill. In response to this, he gathered many well-known scientists to pursue options for practicing Catholics to either avoid or achieve pregnancy naturally and in good conscience to the Catholic teaching. Part of this was via natural family planning, one of which is known as the Creighton Model System, which involved learning how daily cervical mucus could determine when a woman was ovulating. Understanding normal physiology, NAPRO was the answer to gynecological health or causes of unhealthy conditions such as endometriosis, painful cycles, menopause, or perimenopause. The Holy Father back in 2001 asked Catholic doctors to be pro-life and not manipulators of life. He stated, "Science and the practice of medicine risk losing sight of the inherent ethical dimension, and healthcare professionals can be strongly tempted at times to become manipulators of life or even agents of death. Until recently, medical ethics and Catholic morality were rarely in disagreement. Normally, Catholic doctors could offer patients all that medical science afforded. Now, there are so many new modalities to prevent and destroy life or unnaturally create life that the situation has changed radically. Now, conception, pregnancy, and childbirth are perceived as a burden or an ailment to be cured rather than a gift from God. The conflict between social pressure and the demands of right conscience can lead to the dilemma of either abandoning the medical profession altogether or of compromising one's convictions. Faced with that tension, we must remember there is a middle path. It is the path of conscientious objection, which ought to be respected by all, especially legislators." So a couple of definitions. There's conception and contraception. Conception must happen for implantation to occur and therefore lead to a pregnancy. Contraception is that which prevents conception of pregnancy. Birth control are devices or medications used to prevent pregnancy via either by preventing conception or implantation into the uterus. The latter, in other words, is embryocidal. Both ways prevent birth. The oral contraceptive pill works via hormones. And these hormones are synthetic, estrogen and progestin. They have several mechanisms of action. They may inhibit ovulation altogether. The estrogen was added to the pill to help control irregular bleeding that was caused by the progestin. The decreased production of cervical mucus occurs via the increased synthetic progestin. This affects sperm transport as well as creating an inhospitable environment for the sperm to live and makes the uterine lining less hospitable for implantation. OCPs are the gateway drug to abortion. Ironically, natural family planning is 98% effective. And this leads us to abortion, which contaminates everything it touches. Since the pill was available in the mid-1960s, Pope Paul VI said it was going to be the downfall of the family, which has since resulted in an increase in abortions, divorce, adultery, and medical assistance of single-family homes. Abortion was the number one cause of death in 2023. It has risks which include increased risk for infection, ruptured ectopic pregnancies, which are pregnancies that occur outside of the uterus, bleeding, as well as mental health issues with increased risk of suicide. Last but not least, transgender dysphoria. This could be the greatest ethical scandal against children other than child trafficking. Let's remember that these children are indeed suffering. And probably the most important thing that I learned at this conference, and I'm somewhat embarrassed to say, is that God loves these children the same as he loves me or you. The rates are suggestive of 1.4% of children between the ages of 13 and 17 have some sort of transgender dysphoria. This is from insurance data reporting that currently 42,000 children in the U.S. under 18, and this is likely underreported. In the past 5 years, there's been a tenfold increase in transgender dysphoria. This group of adolescents have an increased risk of depression, anxiety, suicide, and substance use. What are the options that are out there? Well, there's a wait and see approach, which finds that 85% improve and realign back to their normal gender. We can proceed with psychotherapy, and if we can help decrease the anxiety, the depression, and the substance use, they will probably realign as well. And then the third option is the social affirmation and acceptance. This is done with puberty blockers, such as GnRH agonists, that stop or halt puberty by blocking the normal pulsatile release of hormones FSH and LH, which eventually go on to make the testosterone and estrogen that drives puberty. This is then followed by cross-sex hormones, so giving a boy estrogen, giving a girl testosterone, and then finally followed by surgery. Deeper emotional problems are usually not improved by hormones or surgery. It has long been believed that if there's a problem with the body, surgery was the best option. If there was a problem with behavior or emotional thinking, that therapy was the best option. It appears they want to do surgery to repair an emotional issue. In the past, Europe had been quite aggressive with their treatment of transgender dysphoria. They felt that they would have better outcomes if they could start before puberty commenced on the child, as they would look more like the gender they would choose to be when they were adults. It was known that testosterone is a very powerful hormone, and if it could be blocked earlier, then boys had a better chance of looking more female when they got older. What they had noticed from the past was that adult transitioning was actually pretty rare. Suicide rates and complications, however, were not. The Dutch had a similar hypothesis, and theirs was similar as they noted that they might have better physiological outcomes for kids and better socialization if they started early. Remember, there's a difference between physiologic and psychologic. The assumptions that were made at the time was if they could start pre-pubertal, they would have better outcomes. It was also felt that the dysphoria might worsen if puberty was allowed to progress and if they did nothing at all. Unfortunately, they excluded mental health issues at the time, like anxiety or depression, and they focused more on social transition, and if they had a good family support, social support, they thought that they would get better outcomes. They also thought that if the child truly understood the biological reality, that they would get a better outcome as well. They didn't have a lot of subjects. They started with 111 in 2012 and were down to 70 by 2014, and eventually that decreased to 55 by the end of the study. They started, as we discussed, with puberty blockers first, followed by cross hormones, and then surgery at 18, although 8% of the surgeries had actually occurred on minors. Their results showed no significant psychological improvements. There were only those two studies, and they were done, and many of the participants were lost to follow-up. Both studies were small in number and short in duration. It showed that there was strong suicidal ideation, up to 50 times greater chance of committing suicide. The long-term studies are actually only about 9 years out, with only about half completing. They felt that only 20% truly had an identity change. 30 to 40% had fertility loss, and a quarter of the surgeries had complications. So what are the risks? Well, we don't really know what the long-term safety data is on puberty blockers. We know that there are potential risk of cross-sex hormones. Estrogens increase one's risk for venous thromboembolisms or clots, as well as liver dysfunction. Some of the irreversible side effects of estrogen therapy are increased breast tissue and decreased testicular size. Testosterone can worsen some blood conditions, and it too has liver dysfunction problems. The irreversible side effects are deepened voice and enlarged female vaginal parts. It was noted that surgery created infertility issues and that mental health issues increase the risk of suicide in this group from above the baseline. So currently many European countries such as Finland, Sweden, England, Norway, Denmark, France, and Belgium are now waiting until at least 18 years for surgeries, and many have restricted access to hormone therapy, partly due to the increase in mortality rate, as the suicide rate is so much higher than normal. They have noticed increased in psychiatric hospitalizations, and they are recommending actually an increase in psychiatric support. But despite European countries trying to slow down their previous aggressive tendencies, the American Academy of Pediatrics is still recommending reaffirming hormones and surgery. St. John Paul II may have been a conspiracy theorist back in the day when he predicted this culture of death. Whether it be birth control, abortion, or population control, between the World Health Organization and the World Economic Forum, they have become the manipulators of death and manipulators of life and agents of death. This is now all done by man-made hands. Ultimately, it is a conspiracy against life. Understand, the World Health Organization is wanting to be in control of the next pandemic, not the United States government. There is consideration underway right now to allow governments to hand over their control to the World Health Organization so they can tell us what to do. COVID was essentially the breaking of one's water who is in labor, but now there may be larger labor pains, the next pandemic, which they're already working on, and some people have been calling it the X virus. They don't know what it will be, but they are working on vaccines now. The World Health Organization and the World Economic Forum think they are gods. What they really are secular messianists. It was the devil's pride that brought death about into the world. He is the father of lies and is more happy to see what is going on with the World Economic Forum and the World Health Organization. These people really don't care about you. They truly want to depopulate the world. That's a lot. So I want to pump you up before we go because this was kind of heavy. So I think we're all looking for the truth. There's subjective truth, like I like pizza, and then there's objective truth. And science always seems to answer the questions about what happened and how it happened. But don't forget about spiritual truth, which answers the questions who and why. Truth is like a lion. You don't need to defend it. Just let it loose, it will defend itself. The closer we are to God, the more we see like him. He helps us see what the devil is really up to. So what can we do? There is so much, but to do something, we must make a move, and that starts with just a simple step, and that step should start today. I was listening to Bible in a Year recently when Pharaoh was asked when he would like Moses to clean up the frog mess. And his answer was, tomorrow. And it's a strange answer, but we are similar to Pharaoh with stopping activities that we should stop or starting things that we should. So I'd like to share with you some things that I've stumbled upon by listening to others, things I've heard or read, and most of these have actually occurred since the CIA knocked on my phone. And hopefully these will motivate us not to be afraid. So St. Joan of Arc stated as a teenager, "I am not afraid. I was born for this," which just is amazing to me. Isaiah in chapter 6 states, "Here I am, Lord, send me." We already talked about Mary's fiat. So we have things that we can work on. And the first one would be fasting, which I'm awful at. But fasting helps protect us against the lust of flesh. Tithing protects us against the lust of material goods. And praying tends to protect us against the pride of life. In the Bible, it says often, many times, be strong and of good courage. At the end of, I think, Joshua, "As for me and my family, we choose the Lord." I believe it was at the end of Judges in the Bible where there was no leader and everyone just did as they pleased. And that's what it feels like is going on in society right now. If you don't know what to believe, the world will tell you what to believe. If not you, then who? And if not now, then when? Ezekiel 22:30 states, "Thus I have searched among them for someone who would build a wall or stand in the breach before me to keep me from destroying the land, but I found no one." Father Michael often talks about his five stones, the five stones that David took against Goliath. He states that these are the rosary, confession, the Eucharist, scripture, which I would throw a plug out for Bible in a year or catechism in a year, as well as fasting. C.S. Lewis said there are two types of people: those that say, "God, your will be done," and those people to whom God says, "Your will be done." Pope Benedict said, and I paraphrase, "Being a Christian is not the result of an ethical choice of some lofty ideal to be good or to shoot for the stars because of good morals, but it is the result of an encounter with a person. That encounter gives us life, a new horizon, and sets us in a new direction." I can't even begin to remember all those encounters, but I know we have all had them. Some stick out more than others. To thank everyone for those encounters would take too long, and I share just a small amount of them tonight. But my best encounter to date, other than my parents and family, would be that girl, my wife. You know, they say behind every man is a great woman. My wife supported me 100%. She never questioned my choice, ever, and I knew that it would be okay. So thank you, babe. Second would be my children, who never complained about the changes that would be inevitable and how it would affect them. They never showed it if they were scared or worried. Thirdly, St. Gianna Clinic, who never ever questioned my beliefs and believed in me. The great priests of the Fox Valley who shared their wisdom as I struggled and still struggle with being a doctor during COVID. And lastly, my COVID support groups, and you all know who you are. Thank you for instilling hope during some very low days. This may answer your question. I was listening to someone somewhere who said, sometimes, especially with us doctors, because we've had so much education, we believe that we must always know the right thing, and sometimes we don't question things like others do, nor can we admit when we are wrong. So I hope to leave you with some good news, and I just saw this not too long ago, and I think he explains it well.
Humanity is depending on everybody who has a position from which to see what is taking place, to grapple with what it might mean, to describe it so that the public understands where their interests are. It is depending on us to do what needs to be done if we're to have a chance of delivering a planet to our children and our grandchildren that is worthy of them, if we're going to deliver a system that allows them to live meaningful, healthy lives. We have to speak up. And I don't know. I don't know how to get people to do that. I'm very hesitant to urge others to put themselves or their families in danger. And I know that everybody's circumstances are different. Some people are struggling just simply to feed a family and keep a roof over their heads. Those people obviously have a great deal less liberty with respect to standing up and saying what needs to be said. But this is really, it's what we call in game theory a collective action problem. Everybody responds to their personal well-being. If everybody says that's too dangerous to stand up, I'm not suicidal, I can't do it, then not enough people stand up to change the course of history. Whereas if people somehow put aside the obvious danger to their ability to earn and maybe to their lives of saying what needs to be said, then we greatly outnumber those we are pitted against. They are ferociously powerful, but I would also point out this interesting error. So I call the force that we're up against Goliath, just so I remember what the battle is. Goliath made a terrible mistake, and it made it most egregiously during COVID, which is it took all of the competent people, took all of the courageous, and it shoved them out of the institutions where they were hanging on. And it created, in so doing, the dream team. Created every player you could possibly want on your team to fight some historic battle against a terrible evil. All of those people are now at least somewhat awake. They've now been picked on by the same enemy. And yeah, all right, we're outgunned. It has a tremendous amount of power, but we've got all of the people who know how to think. So I hate to say it, or maybe I like to say it, but I don't think it's a slam dunk, but I like our odds.
I've never met a more fluent biologist, I have to say. Brett Weinstein, amazing how good you are.
So I'd like to end in prayer. Father, we give you praise, thanksgiving, and glory. Help us not be afraid. Give us the courage to continue to rely on you. Let us continue to be obedient to you. Provide us the truth that will help us be wise as we follow you. In Ephesians, it says, "For our struggle is not with flesh and blood, but with principalities, with powers, with world rulers of this present darkness, with evil spirits in the heavens. Therefore, put on the armor of God that you may be able to resist on the evil day, and having done everything, to hold your ground. Give us fortitude to continue to persevere when times are challenging." Now, I did mention to you that challenge, and that any one of you could have and probably should have given this talk. We are all called to be brave and not to be afraid. We all touch each other's lives when we live our lives trying to do God's work. You never know what you may say or do that will sometime or somehow have a huge impact or influence on someone else's life. If you were accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I hope to see you all in jail. So I think it might be two questions. How do you find out more information about NAPRO and also about natural family planning?
Correct.
Is that correct?
Yeah. Well, is NAPRO the model?
So natural family planning, there's several, and I may have to defer to one of my colleagues. There are several models for natural family planning. The Creighton model is one specific one that helps people kind of achieve pregnancy through checking their mucus and so forth. Let's say you had a problem getting pregnant. That's where NAPRO, it might be surgical, it might be hormonal. That's where the NAPRO technology part, as I understand it, fits in to help achieve pregnancy if you can't get it done with with the crate model natural family planning. So our fertility nurses help teach people how to get pregnant. And then the OBs and the GYN, the OBs tend to keep them pregnant, or if they're having trouble, get them to the point where they can get pregnant. Does that answer that question? I think the fertility nurses will help do those classes with people that are interested. So they can call the clinic to get more information. But usually it's the fertility nurses work with them with the crate model, and then if they're running into problems, then they'll get them referred on to the OB to the OBs. So I think, if I heard you right, is there an increase in ADHD as well as autism and being on the spectrum? Does that sound right? Okay. So it's interesting. I feel like I have two lives. I had one life when I was at Affinity, and then I have this life at St. Gianna. The patient population is a little bit different. I have a lot more homeschoolers. So the learning is different. I still have homeschoolers who struggle with ADHD. I would say it's less, and I'm not sure if it's just the family dynamics that are that way where I'm at. The autism rates, you know, it depends on what you look at. Wisconsin has very good autism services, so a lot of people come into the state because they diagnose autism easier. So the services are more available. I would probably say I have the same amount of autistic kids at St. Gianna than I did at Ascension. I don't know if it's increasing as much as we are maybe better at diagnosing it, where before it may have just been they were mentally retarded. Now we actually have a diagnosis and they can get therapy through the school, so a lot of people will use autism. I've just heard, and I think they're trying to get rid of some of the autistic nomenclature and just put it under one big umbrella. So I don't know if it's necessarily increasing. Certainly our world today is kind of strange. There's a lot of spiritual negativity. I was talking with a gentleman at This Man Is You, actually a deacon, and it's interesting that many people don't believe in the spiritual life. They don't believe the devil is real. And it's scary. So our nutrition's horrible. We're on the screens too much. There could be many, many reasons for it. I don't know if it's necessarily increasing. I don't see as much of it at St. Gianna Clinic. Now, is that because God's there? I don't know. I'd like to think so, but I think everybody heard that question. So what can you do to raise teens? It's tough. I just had read, and I wanted to go to it, there was a nun, believe it or not, who was giving a talk on how to raise kids. And she has done like amazing research at Stanford University. And I want to go see what she has to say, because what I read was very interesting, and I can't remember what her name was, but I'm sure if you look up a nun giving a talk on behavior in teenagers, you'll probably find it. I'd probably say some of the best things you could do, and they're simple. We need to start eating together as families so you can know what's going on with your teenagers. The other thing is, they got to get off their screens, and they got to get off of them at 2 years of age. I am blown away how many two-year-olds can navigate a phone better than I can. And if they don't get to where they're going, they have no self-control. It's like if the internet is slowed down, they are screaming and hollering. So eat as a family, get to know your kids, know what they're up to. Don't feel bad if they're mad at you. I think it's hard as parents. We don't want our kids. We want to give them everything, but we can't. Sometimes saying no might be the best answer. I don't know. I don't know how it is in Canada. I mean, I've contemplated this about many things. I was actually at a stage in my life where I really considered walking away from medicine, and I could just because I'm old. So, you know, I said I was going to become a truck driver, or I was going to work construction. I would have done whatever, just until I turned 65, and I could have financially afforded it. I feel bad for some of the new doctors who come out with unbelievable burden of debt, and are they gonna walk away? I don't know what I would have done if I was, you know, 32 right out of residency with $200,000 worth of debt. Would I have been as bold to say, well, I'm leaving my job? I don't know. What was the second question?
I asked you about how this works and how do they buy into it? Is it peer pressure or is it the government? I know the government pushes.
Yeah, my guess, and we'll talk a little bit about this when I wrap things up. Money talks. You know, if you don't believe in God, what do you care? You know, so if you don't believe in the devil, you can do all kinds of stuff. It's tough being Catholic. You know, it'd be a lot easier to do just whatever you wanted, but God holds us to a higher standard. So there are some doctors who probably just don't care. How do abortionists do abortion? Beats me. I don't know, but they're still out there that like to do it. They can make a good living at it. I mean, I don't want to have to answer when I go in front of God to say, what have I been doing with my life?
And from personal experience, from young kids that I've met, what do you think is a good age for us to use of cell phones? Because some of the most rounded, most well-behaved, nice kids on that do not have cell phones.
Yeah, I have a lot of homeschoolers who they don't have cell phones. I always come back to, what is a phone for? I mean, communication, not to search the internet, not to go on Snapchat. I mean, texting is nice, but I mean, I'm so old. I'm sure some of you remember party lines. You know, you had to share a phone from your own house, and now it's like everybody has their own phone, sometimes two. So, you know, my kids had cell phones. I think we gave them internet when they were 16, 17, but I'm just as bad as everybody else. Yeah. So I would wish they would go back to just flip phones. My easy answer is I would just keep calling him the same name over and over and over and over and never use a pronoun. If Billy wants to be Susie, then I'm just going to say Susie, 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 Susie. I don't know how to answer that question. I certainly don't want to insult them. I think the toughest part is we have to love everyone. But that doesn't mean we have to do everything that they want us to do. We have to treat them with respect. And if me calling them Susie all the time, that's maybe as respectful as I can get. But I don't want to have to be forced to use somebody's pronouns. It's interesting. I used to ask three-year-olds all the time, are you a boy or a girl? And I'd never had anybody ever get that question wrong. I'm now somewhat afraid to ask for offending somebody. I don't think it would happen at the clinic, but back where I was, I would be fearful that somebody would say, well, that you can't ask that question. That's a very loaded question. I would have never questioned it until COVID. And when I talk with my patients now, we talk about safe, effective, and needed. So we have this conversation with parents. I respect their decisions. I don't know what the answer is. I don't think I'm ever going to find out the answer because I don't think I'm going to get the truth. I hate my job. It's so hard because I don't want to do anything wrong either way. And it's tough. It wears me out. I can't wait to retire because I don't know. I mean, I'm going to work probably until 65, but if I've messed up along the way, I'm going to have some serious regrets, and I'm not going to be able to find the truth. I don't know where it's going to come from, so faith plus reason. So safe, effective, needed.
I just want to say thank you for standing up as a man of faith. That's very hard to do in this world. Something that I try to do, and I don't know how well I do it all the time. I know my kids are going to miss your hair. So, my wife and our kids, they'll see you and they love you as long as you keep wearing the crazy outfits that I hear about at home. But I know they'll miss your hair. But just I want to say thank you. It's so important that we have men like you in this world, and you are making a difference, so thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.